message on its own. So how does a SOAP message look? Like I've been stressing from the beginning, it is a simple XML document. It has a fixed structure with four basic elements. One is the envelope element, another one is the header, and then the body, and finally the fault element. What are they? Let us have a look at it. Right? See, now consider that there are no phones and you are writing letter to your friend. Right? A postal letter, what it has? It has the envelope on which we write, we have the stamp and we write the address, that is we write the from and the to, and then we also mention return to address, which can be the from address itself. So these details on a postal letter will tell how the letter will be received and what to do in case of any failure, like what to do in case of the absence of the person who will receive the letter and so on, right? Same way, a SOAP message has a fixed structure. The envelope is the one that identifies that this particular XML document is a SOAP message, okay? And it has the details of the namespace and the encoding, that is the way in which this SOAP message is going to go and how this SOAP message should be interpreted, okay? And the header. The header can be assumed like the notes that we write on the top of the cover, like let us say we write book post or quick mail service, etc., right? What type of information is there inside this particular letter? That is specified in the header. And the body is your actual letter contents, which will be communicated to your SOAP web service. So then you will also be seeing the fault, which is like the return to address, that is going to have the errors and statuses of the error messages, right? So let me just show you a simple SOAP request. This is a very simple SOAP request. So the SOAP envelope has the namespace, which is a standard URL specified by a World Wide Web organization, and encoding style, which is again a standard encoding style specified by World Wide Web organization. And then it has very specific tags which are specifically designed for that particular web service, which will have details of the operations of the web service and the input or output corresponding to that web service, right? So if we see in the example that we have seen now, you see here, there is a SOAP envelope. It has the namespace and the header is here. And in the body, you have the method name, that is get conversion rate, which you see here, right? And then it has two inputs. The inputs are specified in specific tags. And then the SOAP envelope ends. So this structure makes a SOAP message very powerful to transport data from a web service and get output from a web service also, right? Some important thing here, there are certain very fixed components in a SOAP message. This is a little advanced, but it is good to know. So when you have a SOAP message, there are certain fixed attributes like must understand, which will say if the header is mandatory or not. Generally, the header is not mandatory. So in some web services, you might not see the header. And actor tells about the endpoint, that is the endpoint URL or the URI, right, where this particular web service is deployed. And encoding, apart from SOAP's encoding structure, if there are any specific encoding, that can also be specified in the SOAP message, right? A simple SOAP response, on the other hand, will look something like this. So in HTTP, 200 stands for a successful response. And following that, there will be the response content which we received. If you see here in our example, I can show the same. So here, if I go to this raw side, you see here, I have the HTTP response 200 OK, which is the success message. And then I have the header information, like what is the type of the content, how long it is and all. And if I come to the XML site, I have the result also, right? So this is how SOAP is helping web services to take inputs and give us outputs, right? This SOAP structure is going to be fixed, okay? And in case of fault, there is going to be standard fault structure. Like each fault has a fault code or a fault number, and then there is going to be a fault string which will explain what type of fault it is, and then there is going to be a fault actor which will specify at which server or at which point while reaching the URL there was a fault. And additionally, there can be a detail which will tell you in detail what happened during the process which failed, right? And some examples of the fault codes are version mismatch, client, which indicates that there was a problem with the client itself, and server, which indicates that there was a problem with the server, and must understand, which indicates that there was a header expected but the recipient did not have a header information, right? So how this SOAP message travels through HTTP, that is very interesting. The SOAP message first is triggered from the client, like how we did in SOAP UI now. So we send it to the endpoint and it travels over HTTP and it reaches the endpoint. If the web service at the endpoint gives us the correct response, the HTTP response comes in SOAP format with the HTTP success code 200. On the other hand, if there is any failure, we will get the failure and fault trace message also. Okay, so a SOAP UI request can travel with ease over HTTP because it is very lightweight, provided the data intensity is less. Finally, to sum up, HTTP with XML makes SOAP a very powerful protocol. It gives platform and language independency. It is a simple self-explanatory XML document with a fixed structure, that is header, body, and the actual message contents and the fault codes, right? So these elements are fixed and they follow the W3C standards very clearly, okay? So today what I have covered till now is I have just covered the basic setting up of a test suite, pinging your web service from SOAP UI by supplying inputs to the SOAP request and getting the SOAP response. And we have seen what this SOAP request and response structure is like and how it helps web services to communicate over HTTP, right? So we have some 5 minutes left. I would like to take up as many questions as possible. I see already there are so many questions. There might be some questions that can be repeated or that can be left out. So you can always get back on that question once I have mentioned a mail ID to which you can send your questions as well, for which I'll be able to get back to you and answer, right? So now let me start taking the questions. Okay, someone has asked me whether WSDL file will be shared to us by development team. Please explain. Definitely WSDL file URL will be shared to you if they are asking you to test it. Without that WSDL file URL, it is very, very difficult to test a web service. Okay. Someone has asked me what is the tester's role here and what information we will get from the developer. I'm repeating again, you will get the WSDL file URL, and in some cases, if it is a very complicated web service, you might also get the WSDL file, what the web service description is all about, what that web service is doing, and you will be expected to use a tool like SOAP UI to perform your functional test on that particular web service, right? So someone says, how could we give multiple inputs for the add operation? You can definitely give multiple inputs for add operation. That functionality is not directly present in SOAP UI, but it is present in SOAP UI Pro. SOAP UI Pro offers a lot of options to give multiple inputs to a single request. You can use JDBC databases, you can use a simple grid, you can use CSV files, or SOAP UI itself, SOAP UI Pro itself has its own data-driven test functionality which you can use. I will show a demo on that when we move on to SOAP UI Pro. Someone is asking me, in real time, how do we know it is passed or correct? The input and output specification for web services will be given to you before you start testing. So for that sample input and output, you have to check if the WSDL, that is your web service, is responding correctly. I have one more question which says, how to get the WSDL URL? Your development team will give it to you. For practicing, I can suggest you some WSDL URLs. Which I can add to the notepad of today's notes. Someone has asked me, where do we have to write test cases for web service, in Excel sheet or in SOAP UI? SOAP UI itself provides a functionality to describe your test cases. We will see that one example as we go on. I have one more question. Ma'am, the endpoint of this web service is this URL. This URL that I used today for showing you this weathercast is a SOAP web service URL, just that the URL of that website had the name RESTful Services. It is not a REST service, it is a SOAP service. Okay. No, that URL ended with WSDL. If you have missed that, let me just show it to you. That URL did end with WSDL. I'm just going to show that. The website is named after RESTfulWebServices.net, but it is a SOAP WSDL URL. You can see here it has ended with the WSDL extension. Okay. Okay, for some of them have said, I have joined late, did I miss anything? You will get the recorded link. You can have a look at it. Do I need to install SOAP UI in my PC to practice? Yes, you have to practice by installing SOAP UI on your machine. For sample web services, I will give you some sample open source web service URLs which you can practice. Does SOAP UI support HTTPS web service? Yes, it supports HTTPS web services. It also, it in fact has some SSL related handling capacity also as far as HTTPS services are concerned. Are you planning to send PowerPoint notes every day after session? This will help us. Yes, definitely you will get the PowerPoint notes and the notepad notes at the end of every day. Yesterday there was a little delay. You'll be getting yesterday's and today's maximum by tomorrow morning. There is a question called, is there any architecture for a web service? The architecture of a web service depends upon the need or the expected work from that web service. It goes through a formal design process and then it gets coded. It really changes from case to case. Okay. For multiple inputs question, I have already answered. You can use SOAP UI Pro's features there. It is very powerful. If you want to do it in SOAP UI, you will have to write either Groovy script or you can also write JavaScript. What is the need of HTTP when SOAP is itself a protocol? SOAP is just a message transfer guy. He is the one who carries the letter, but HTTP is like the road. You cannot ask why do I need road when I have the postman. The postman has to walk on the road. SOAP UI needs HTTP to travel across, right? And then Do we require Tomcat server? You don't require Tomcat server to test in your environment. Nothing of this sort is required. Just use these URLs which I'll be adding to the notepad and sending you, and you can install SOAP UI and do the same way that we did today. Okay.